Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Holy Family Parish and to this celebration of the sacrifice of the Mass. Today is Palm Sunday of the Passion of the Lord. This Mass is being offered for John F. Sizz. Parish announcements are as follows. Confessions will take place this Sunday, March 28th at 4 p.m. Drive-through confession will be available. Bishop Byrne asks everyone to pray for increased vocations, April 1st, Holy Thursday. Come to the Parish Center to the Altar of Repose after Holy Thursday Mass from 8 to 9 p.m. for this intention. Pope Francis has asked parishes to support the Pontifical Good Friday Collection, which helps support Christians, schools, parishes, and caring for refugees in the Holy Land. Adoration is on Wednesdays from 12 to 6 p.m. with benediction at 6. Confessions are held on Wednesdays at 5 p.m., Saturdays at 3 p.m., and by appointment. Bishop Byrne will preside at a holy hour to pray for vocations in our diocese on Thursday, April 8th, at the Newman Catholic Center at UMass from 7 to 8 p.m. A question and answer with Bishop will follow. Confessions will be available. All are welcome to come and pray, especially men discerning a call to the priesthood.
Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My dear brethren, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today, we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it, and will send it back to you at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them, just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brethren, like the crowds who acclaim Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace. cross. Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word to rouse them. Morning after morning, he opened my ear, that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore, I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Again, Pilate questioned him.
Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of.
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with a man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with
"Hail, be introduced,"
and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting on him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Syrian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. They then crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha, you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Save yourself by coming down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, and we may see him and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which is translated,
"My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, he is calling Elijah."
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take you down."
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who was facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Divine law. What's the mark? The mark is namely God. So you and I have been created in the image and likeness of God, and therefore are meant to act accordingly, according to how we have been created. Sin, therefore, can be characterized as those moments, those instances, when we do not think, speak, or act according to how we were created. When we do not think, speak, or act in a God-like manner. When we miss the mark of being more God-like in the way we think, speak, and act. And that has consequences for within our souls. That has consequences within the body of the church. We get the word sin, or our English word for sin, comes from the German Sünde. Familiar with the word sunder, to rend asunder, right? It means to tear apart. That's what sin does. Sin tears apart our relationship with God. It causes division amongst ourselves, within the church, within our relationships, and with God. When we sin, when we do not think, speak, or act in a God-like manner, we cause division within ourselves, within the body of Christ. Whether our sins are public or private, we cause a disharmony in the body of Christ. We cause a disharmony within ourselves, in our relationships. When we sin, we crucify the Savior again and again and again. Did you happen to know that, and I just recently found this out, that Holy Week, this week, Holy Week, was once called the Week of Reconciliation? Why? Because that's precisely what this mission is. The mission of Christ is a mission of reconciliation. When we celebrate these liturgies of Holy Week, I was saying to someone, but before this Mass, I think before the 8 o'clock Mass, how beautiful these liturgies are and how complicated they also are. But these are real events. This is the holiest week of our Christian lives. This is the most important week that we can ever celebrate as Catholics, because this week makes present to us the mission of our Redeemer. This isn't pageantry. This is real. These are real events that took place at one time, sure, in history, 2,000 years ago. But we relive these events now, in our own time, in our own history. The mission of the Redeemer, Christ, comes to us again and again. Every single Holy Week, he gets down to our level and he raises us up. We celebrate Holy Thursday, that beautiful day when he instituted the Holy Priesthood and the Eucharist and the pattern of our worship. And from that liturgy, we move into the altar of repose. We move into the agony in the garden with him. We enter into his suffering with him. We walk the road of Calvary with him on Good Friday. We rise with him again on Easter Sunday. This isn't pageantry. These are real events made present to us again. We relive the mission of Christ, whose mission is a mission of reconciliation, a mission to call us back, to repair what has been torn, to bring back what has been put back together, what has been broken within us because of our sins. Christ puts us back together. He makes us whole. He brings us back in right relationship with himself, with the church, and with others via this mission of redemption. Christ's mission is a mission of salvation. It's a rescue mission. And he's come to rescue us from the damage that we do to ourselves because of our sins. We ought not let this week pass us by without making reconciliation, without making confession, without emptying the emptiness, the darkness, and the division that we've caused because of our sins, to empty that out to Christ this week especially, so that he can repair it, so that he can bring us back into right relationship with himself, with the church. We have to let Christ then fulfill his mission of redemption, his mission of reconciliation in us. This week in particular,
response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For Pope Francis and leaders of the church, may the Lord bless their efforts to spread the gospel to all. Let us pray to the Lord. For lawyers and judges, may God's just judgment inform them in seeking the truth, justice, and dignified treatment for all who come before them. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who are persecuted, may the Lord bless them with strength and patience in bearing their crosses and hope in enduring their sufferings. Let us pray to the Lord. For each one of us gathered here today, may God lead us in this season of Lent to repentance and conversion. Let us pray to the Lord. We pray for the clergy of the Franklin County Deanery, especially for clergy who are sick. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who have died, may they know eternal peace and joy in the kingdom of heaven. Let us pray to the Lord. This Mass is being offered for John F. Sizz. Let us pray to the Lord. For the intentions that we hold in the silence of our hearts, let us pray to the Lord.
We pray also for those who have fallen victims to the recent violence in our country, for the consolation of their families, for peace in our nation and throughout the world. Let us pray to the Lord. For an increase in vocations to religious life, especially the priesthood so needed in our diocese, let us pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we humbly ask that you hear the prayers we bring to you on this day, pray and accord with your most holy will. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our justification. so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Order of bishops, all the clergy, and
granted peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
lives and reigns